than myself because the character obviously mutates, spoiler alert. So I was just really grateful for it. I was really surprised. And I didn't realize Mass Effect was so huge either when I put that. So it was like, I guess this is how video games go if they're not Japanese based. So, because I do a lot of those games and nobody seems to care. So I was really grateful for those two roles.
Just let you know, Tech is on their way.
I did the billboard voiceovers, not for that, but for a thing called Mirror's Edge, which I think it comes out or has come out, or is it out yet? Is it out with the English dub? Did you hear English when you were playing? Well, that's me. That you don't know.
Mirror's Edge 2.
It's like, what language do you dream in?
Mirror's Edge 2?
Well, anyway, that was produced by the same people, and the guy who was running the session, I said, are you worried about the Geth? Are they going to be in Andromeda? Because I'm the voice of the Geth. And he's like, I can't tell you anything. But he looked at me, he's like, don't hold your breath. So, yeah. As far as the Mass Effect stuff, we record alone, so it's not like I can tell you stories about Transformers Rescue Bots, where we record as a group and stuff like that. But I will say that it was nice that it was very, the audition process for that was actually long. The first audition I had was a requiem that I had to say, like a Friends, Romans, Countrymen thing. It was like almost a year later that I got an audition again. It was a callback and I didn't know it. And then it was actual Legion dialogue. And if you Google that, on YouTube, DC Douglas Legion audition. Same with Chase and Rescue Bots. I put both those auditions up online as part of the blog post I did. And it's kind of fascinating to hear how I sounded in the audition, because I sound very, like Chase Rescue Bots sounds very mean almost. Everything is by book. And in Legion, I actually sound mean as well. Apparently, I'm just very angry when I'm auditioning. Like, why do I have to audition? But anyway, it's a fantastic difference. But Jimmy McSwain, the only real notable thing about that is that Jimmy McSwain is the director on Mass Effect 2, and it's because of her that I'm on Transformers Rescue Bots, because she would cast that and directs that show. And it's one of those things, like, anybody could have done the role of Chase. It's one of those voices that is very simple to do. But I was put in the short list because she saw my name and said, oh, DC Douglas left working with him. And that's a lot about how life is, if you like people like working with you, you can work well.
That's my story.
I saw a question over here. How was the recording process for that game playing as a baby?
That's right, something none of you know about. They have a playback of the animatics, so you only see like blocky figures that you're recording to. I don't know the franchise. Again, it's one of those things where I was like, do a book, you got a session, and they always have some other name for what the project is because everyone's silly secret about it. So you don't know, you don't go out going, I don't even know the context, I don't know what my character looks like. I've got a Japanese producer who's being translated who's like, no more. So I'm like listening to those bands. So they're playing a Japanese guy, and
everything's down here.
So that's what I have to do for the voice. So I
say the lines like this.
And like, to me, I'm like, I'm just a big announcer. And he's like, oh, they love that. So I record it all like that. Then I like to grab little cutscenes and throw on my website. So a year later, it's out or whatever. I find the cutscenes. I go there. And he's a black man. He's Wesley Snipes. And like, so a couple things here. Problematic. One, there are plenty of black voice actors that they should have cast for that. But regardless, it's good for me to know it's Wesley Snipes. So when I went to do Street Fighter X Tekken, and I go, so here's your, we're going to play a sample of what you did for the game. I'm like, no, I'm going to be doing the voice differently. So he's a little more gruffer and more badass in that, and less announcer type. So yeah, I wasn't too impressed with my that one. I'm trying to win it though. So we got it out. Let's see if we got audio here. I'm going to just jump into this weird thing. He's going to get a Andrew Miller. So, who here saw the cartoon last night that I played? You were right there. Okay, do you mind if I play it one more time for them? Okay, so there's a cartoon. Here's the thing about the fan. This is what I love about you guys. There's so much talent in the fan base. And I ran across this one fan. Actually, I ran across her before I knew she was a fan of mine, but she did like these Resident Evil special effects videos on YouTube. And I went, wow, check this channel out. I put it on my Facebook page. Year later, she discovers my Twitter and Facebook, and so she sends me like little drawings that she does and about my characters and like with humor and all. And I go, wow, that's really cool that she did that. And so we started up like a friendship online, and then I said, hey, you know, I really want a creative outlet. But I don't want to spend a lot of money. Would you want to animate a short little script if I did it? And she said yes. That was one of those things where I said afterwards, I went, so we can either just throw this online, or we can do the film festival circuit with it if you like. She goes, let's do film festival circuit. So you guys can't see this online yet. We've already won best film and best animated short in this one, the Westchester Film Festival or something. Anyway, but we're in like 8 other film festivals. So, what's fun about this is then I went to some of my friends and acquaintances and I said, I wanted a packet full of Resident Evil voice actors because it's a zombie related. And so Steve Bloom said yes, and I got, the name is, what's her name? You know her, anyway. And her and her, Travis Willingham is her husband.
Laura Bailey.
Thank you, Laura Bailey's in it, and Matt Mercer, Courtney Taylor. I mean, but they've got little tiny little voice things, especially all, majority of them are all in this 7 seconds of the film. Roger Taylor Smith, Roger Craig Smith. He is, he's got a very special one, you'll be able to see. So anyway, so it's 5 minutes long, should I play it for you?
Yes.
Okay, here we go. Matthew.
In the beginning, there was peace. Then Matt said, let's f*** things up. And they did. And it was pretty f***ed up. So much so that the land was contaminated with radiation and chemicals and biological goo. 99% of the population perished. Then rose back up as zombies looking to feast on millennium flesh, blah, blah, blah. Most of the 1% that survived were stupid and didn't leave the cities. They just walked around talking incessantly.
Who are the dead, Carl? Who are the dead? You ever thought about that?
Yeah. Thankfully, most of their parents as well.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. One little girl was smart enough to run away from the city and take refuge in a little cabin on top of a little hill.
It's always best to take the high ground.
This little girl is Ginger.
Hi, I'm Ginger.
Ginger spends most of her days.
Oh, you want to play Call the Resident Zombies on a Judy with me?
Please, I'm narrating.
Sorry.
I'm just so lonely.
Ginger spends her lonely days acting out her favorite video game. Or she goes shopping for supper. And of course, she walks the cabin's perimeter checking for zombies. A safe endeavor, considering it's been over a year since she arrived and nary a rotting corpse has shuffled up her hill. In fact, truth be told, she's never actually seen a zombie.
It's true.
Until today.
See what?
Is how the heartwarming story of Ginger and Snapper came into being. Ginger and Snap have spent the whole day recapturing her lost innocence, playing silly children's games, picking flowers of friendship, shopping together, and watching the sunset on Ginger's happiest of all post-apocalyptic days. That night, Snap arrived at Ginger's favorite video game, allowing her to riddle his body with bullets again and again. Their friendship blossomed fast, for they both had been lonely for so long. Ginger knew that no matter how bad this pesky post-apocalyptic life gets, she and Snapper will always make the best of it. Because this was more than just a friendship of convenience.
No.
It was a friendship for the ages. friendship that, well...
Spend so long doing a voice acting gig that you ended up using that voice in real life accidentally after he got out of the booth?
No. I wouldn't say that. I mean, it's like that method acting thing or something. So, but I wouldn't say so. I mean, if you're doing something that's very aggressive and energetic when you leave the booth, you're still going to be a little bit aggressive and energetic when you're dealing with other people. But usually, you're like, especially on those ones, you're like, oh, good, I can relax now. So, like doing Azrael and Blaze Blue was like, that was exhausting. I want to eat it. You know, and you leave there like, that's fine. And then, you know, then you talk to me, hi, so nice to have a session. Don't look at my bulk redirects.
That's a random question. Is it true that all voice actors act in their pajamas?
I don't know if it's true or not, but I do in my underwear. Actually, that's my story. I booked a huge campaign called Real People Campaign, which was Denise Basie's a real Geico customer, not a paid celebrity. So tell her story. We hired a celebrity. And then you had Little Richard or Joan Rivers or something like that in the spot. And I don't even. My point being is that was like a one line, you know, one of the many commercials I had that morning. I had at my home booth, and so literally, you know, they needed it back immediately. So before I get dressed up, my mom worked, set the booth, and I did the line. Did it three different ways, two ways to the spec the way that they said they wanted it, and then the third way I was taking Law and Order guy, and the Law and Order guy booked it, and so I said, you know, I booked my house and my underwear, so. That ran for 3 years, and it was insane. So, like, when you get a national campaign, it's insane. But it's like lightning striking. It's lightning striking, and I really would love for it to strike again. So that's occasionally true, unless you're Vic Mignogna and you're doing it all the time. So, I'm kidding. I don't know what it is.
Right here.
Okay. So, first of all,
yes. Thank you, I appreciate that.
And then, what was it like to work on
Sharknado? It's not funny. It was fun. Here's the thing, is I know those producers, the silent people, and I did like six other movies with them prior to that. Movies that you guys have never seen, like 666, The Child, and Scarecrow 2, which by the way, I was in with Tony Todd, who was here. He's a sweetheart, yeah. So it was, here's the thing, so I knew Sharknado was huge, and I'm like, well, why did I get into that? I'm not a celeb, but there's other roles I could have done, but of course, if you're shooting in New York, and it's a silent, they're notoriously cheap, this is how they're able to do what they do, and so I called them, or emailed them, and I said, so listen, you know, so I said, listen, if you guys have an extra role in that, I would be happy to fly myself there and do it. And because I knew that they would have the money for that. They wouldn't like hire an LA actor. Or go, if you have LA shoots, I'm available. And he emailed back like a month later and he goes, turns out Sci-Fi wants to add in this thing about alligators in the sewer because that's one of those New York things. And he said, so I got a role here. I'll send the scene. If you like it, we'll need you in 3 days in Buffalo. And I got to fly myself, put myself up. I have to work as a local hire there because that was part of their contract deal with that city. How they were able to get a lot of what they got. And then I said, hell yeah. I had a con in Ohio, so I went to the con for Friday and Saturday, and then Saturday night I took a red eye and flew to Buffalo. And the next day I was on set. I was in this cavern, this is in winter, and in Buffalo, so it's freezing, and I'm in water with waders that filled up with water because I was doing a lot of running in the water. And it was a silent movie. It's low budget. It's like there's no rehearsal, and you're doing like crazy things. You're like, I'm running on slippery rocks and water. And the actor was with me. He was like a theater actor there, and he didn't know about silent. And he's like, hey, wait, are we going to rehearse this or what? And I'm like, okay, it's a silent movie. It's okay. We just move it through. And he was like, by the end of it, he was not happy with the experience. So I had a blast. And we did this whole thing where the alligators on my chest, and they had this whole compressor thing that went with all this goo and like guts that went onto my face. And it was like, that's what put us into overtime.
And it was like, so I got cold, bloody goo on me, and I'm soaking wet, and it's like about 30 degrees out. So it was like very good, but at the same time, you're like, I love acting. And then you see the movie, and they're like, oh, they cut that part. Yeah, it made me wash away instead, which was mostly that they had a special effects problem they couldn't make. They're like, we're not going to make the alligator, but we don't have time to make an alligator do that. So instead, you just see me sort of wash away, which then led to the short-lived hashtag Mud Lives. But that didn't catch on like I thought it would, and I tweeted that a lot. Yeah, all right, now I think we're good here. You guys want to see, I'll end with my comedy reel, I'll show you my drama reel right now, you want to see it? This will give you a little idea of what I love about doing on-camera stuff. Do I, oh, I'm hooked into somebody's Wi-Fi that's probably really sucky, so hold on here. I think what I have to do is take off my Wi-Fi, force it to 4G, ask you to reload. I'm what do they call it? Hotlinking to my phone.
Hotspotting
to my phone. That's right. You know, baby. Why do you not go? Let's do this. Oh, and now you're going to. What happened? I'm having the worst luck here. Okay, let's try that. Okay, and I've got that on. Shouldn't it work this way, guys? Do you have Wi-Fi? Like, if I go to the Wi-Fi thing, hang on here, I'll go back to the Wi-Fi stuff. Do we go back to my Wi-Fi? Oh, I do have to have that on for my iVirus. But any of these? Oh, you don't? Okay, yeah. You know, only if you knew. They're so cruel to you. All right. We might have luck here. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, come on, AT&T, show me you love me. Hey, we got a question while I see if I'm doing. That's true. I'm just afraid somebody might text something. I'm going to go away. Hang on, let me see if I can load up my phone. That's weird, but that's not doing it. So.
The Wi-Fi here is terrible. I mean, it's just a
signal problem. Yeah.
A bunch of concrete, huge tall buildings, and everybody's using it.
Yeah, I think it's weird. 4G says like you've got like all the bars, but then you go to do something and like the it doesn't
it's
load.
4G
is 4G MI?
So
wow, that's weird.
While we're waiting, we'll have to take this gentleman's question right here.
I did it as a help. No germ line here. On my website, though, somebody did hack through all of it and put spam links on stuff for Viagra. And,
when these go for roles, do they come to you or do you hunt them out?
Usually when it comes to voiceover roles, they come to me. It's just whatever comes to my inbox I audition for. Recording studio I've worked with thinks of me and then have me in. On-camera stuff, it's both from either VMA agent, which is not as many as voiceover-wise, or I do have to pursue it as well. So I do have to pursue a lot of my film stuff. I've done a lot of indie films, which I will not be able to show you because it's not loading. I got 5 bars and no loading. That's weird. All right. Sorry, no more video. Oh, sorry. She's bothering me.
So, how did you
get
the role in special
teams? That was just an audition through my agent. Auditioned. I think I had to look up to Noblium. Wanted to see if I had to say it. I don't even still know if I'm saying it right. And to see like what kind of personality they were, because the script was very vague on that, which is also why we came back to remove it ultimately, because they didn't like the fact that we were being so nice. So, yeah, just one of those who will go in and read the lines. I don't even remember that audition, to be honest with you. I remember getting it, I don't remember auditioning it, and I just remember. I don't even think we had callbacks. I think it was straight to producers, just read it, and then you get the booking, and the next week you're there. It was very exciting. It was really weird, so what you don't realize is if you book on any Star Trek, sorry, this is Star Wars, isn't it? Yeah, if you book any Star Trek universe show, part of the deal is that you get a box sent to you of your characters as a playing card, and you have to sign 1,500 of them for $1,000. And I never realized how hard it is to maintain a signature. After around 100, it's like I started looking weird. Now the funny thing is you can Google DC Douglas Zeft card, and you'll see like one or two on eBay for like $50. So yeah, it's weird. But there are some people that are like, I have a picture that I sell on the signing line. stuff. And I never did, because I thought it was just a tiny role, nobody really gave a shit. And, sorry, whatever. And then I was at a Comic-Con in Florida, whatever, and a guy from England came up to me and had a print from the screen of me and wanted me to sign it. And I was like, well, you know what? Like, I got me thinking, so I did my own print of it. And then actually, I sell a fair amount for those really hardcore. And those are the people that come up and have a list of all the people they need to get. And they're not a fan of me. They're a fan of Star Trek. And so they just want to make sure that they have got everything. Like, I imagine what the garages look like. So.
Me? What's been your worst experience with a bad director?
Oh. Well, I had two stories for you. So one goes way back before everything was streaming. I used to do like industrials and things like that. And I did, I want to shoot my reel. Just go to dcdouglas.com and you can see all the video to your heart's content. I booked this one thing where I was, it was for like the threat of electricity or something and like how to use or whatnot. So I arrived on the set and we're shooting an outdoor location thing and the director comes over to me and he's like, DC Douglas is like, oh yeah, you're my second choice. Yeah, the guy could get it, booked a pilot or something and whatever. And then he like walks away. That is his welcome. So now we're going and we're doing the thing and we arrive. So then he goes, okay, so you're driving up in the Jeep with her, and I'm like, oh, and I go, that's a stick shift, I don't drive a stick. He's like, and already I know he's thinking, he's like, why aren't you my first choice? And how did you get it? I hope somebody sent you a dick pic while we do this. This Oh yeah, this includes, you know, the very first thing is Helen Alone. This is really weird. So, you know, this again, you look for going for your own roles. I found this one thing for a Houston film. I went and auditioned. They haven't had an LA audition thing. I auditioned for, got booked, went to Houston for a week or two different weeks to shoot that. On that shoot, as I play this cop, and on that shoot, I met this special thanks guy who says, "Ah, well, we gotta have you out to be in one of our movies." I'm like, "Yeah, sounds great." Like, you know, it's like that's you get the, when you hear that talk, especially when you're not in LA, you're like, "That's not gonna mean anything." Well, 2 years later, I get an email saying we'd like you to do a small role in this film, and so we were trying to negotiate, and I'm like, and it was the role of a broadcaster, like a journalist guy, and I'm like, I don't like doing those roles because I do voiceover. So I basically was just trying to price them out of it, making it as difficult as possible, so they either pay it or say no, you know, and then that way I feel okay about it. And then they came back and they go, "Well, that if we're gonna pay that much, how about we have you play the lead instead?" And then I was like, "Well, okay." And that turned into a 3.5 week shoot in Houston. It's called KILD TV. And it is, it's just now on iTunes and a couple other things. And then through Resident Evil, fans of mine also did some like really like low budget films, like amazingly low budget, that look really good. And they offered me the role of this serial killer in this film called Apocalypse Kiss. And we decided to do it as a little bit of an homage to Albert Musker. So I've got slick blonde hair, and I actually, it's what got me into shape and I'm staying that way. And so there's that. You'll see that in this here. You want to see KILD. And then, just so you know, a little heads up there on sci-fi, in about a month or two, there's a movie called Isle of the Dead that'll be coming out. And it's with Joey Lawrence and myself, and I'm the bad guy. And that also, that one's through Asylum, and I asked them, I pitched the movie to them 2 years ago, and I said, "Yeah, can we do it as an allusion to like Resident Evil video game fans? Because I love to please them." And they said yes, and so my character's name is Colonel Aiden Wexler. All right, so here's my Colonel.
So we're going to run over a little bit, too.
Are we done?
No, we're
going
to run over.
Tap into Newman's power, right? Harness it. We have the most powerful weapon on the planet.
Get him right here.
these attacks will stop.
So to you as to make successful probability at 75%. And what if I release the blunder? And then God forbid somebody pulls a John Hinckley. Or the president suffers a stroke. Or the tire blows in his limo all the way to the airport and the crash sheet punctures a lung. We have run dozens of scenarios to be prepared for any emergency. Look, someone's waiting in the plane. We're only talking 15 minutes.
Okay, we're getting evacuation for all the boats that we have.
Moving the children first?
Looks like history's repeated itself.
Oh! You've got the fire now! Thank you! Oh, welcome back! God, I am so rooting for you! Yes!
Service canceled. So that's the. Oh, we got a customer. That sucks. The whole idea, lady.
So we don't have like a long list of people that are trying to get really do like the doors. We have
to
do our own. So we have
20
hours
of
Sharpie.
Oh, jeez Louise. Well, I'm not supposed to take the money thingy, so that's somebody else. But the wait, do you have to leave this moment? You're saying? Oh, but tell you what, let me ask another question. Bring that up, and we'll. But that's only this person I'm doing, and it's a rescue boss thing. So that's
about. Is that your question back here?
Yeah. So when you took over the role of Wesker in Resident Evil 5, did you ever think you weren't going to measure up to the gentleman that did it before you? Were you ever like
measure up the whole way? Were you implying? Did I ever? Well, yeah. Well, the thing is I didn't realize how the fans would react once they found out that I was going to be taking over the role. So it was a little, you know, awkward. Especially reading some of the like the hate stuff. Because fans are weird like that. So yeah, there's a little bit of me that we thought. But at the same time, I'm like, yeah, they paid me. So I guess. So yeah, there's a little bit of that.
We'll take it
up to one last, and then those who want to see the comedy reel, which is a little more, not as, it's shorter and more fun than the last one, and then you can all come up and see me. Am I signing, or I'm going to another?
You're going to, I believe.
Signing? Okay, then you can all come up to the signing thing. Yes, sir.
You never finished answering my question before about your worst experience with a bad director.
I didn't do that.
No, you.
I don't know why,
because you got Verizon.
What's the other Verizon problem? That's right, you ruined it. My moderator ruined you. So there was that. So he was like, so I wouldn't drive the Jeep, and then so I had to be the passenger, which I guess in the 80s was like, that was like, you know, he was an asshole. So I get out of the Jeep and I'm doing my line, and he's like, cut. He's like, what are you with the gestures? You're like a high school theater actor. He's like, you're so mean to me. And so he said, put your hands in your pocket when you walk out. So I had my hands in my pocket. To my line like that. So that was the first one. And the second time, it wasn't necessarily a mean director. I think he was just having, I think just the whole set was just an unhappy set to be on. And it was without a trace. And so we go to set. The ladies, my wife and I, we're waiting for the crew comes in, the director doesn't want to read the scene and block it out. And he comes in, he looks like an angry Santa Claus. And he's also a producer of the show. But he comes in and he sits down. And he's like, he points at me, he's like, who are you? And I'm like, I'm DC Douglas, I'm playing the role of blah, blah, blah. And he's like, God damn it. And I'm like, at this point, I'm old enough where that stuff doesn't bother me anymore. So I just kind of like, in my mind, I'm laughing, and I just sit there and I go, did they cast the wrong person? And he's like, no, you're not supposed to be in a sweater, you're supposed to be in a suit. And I'm like, well, that's a weird thing to get that upset about. It's easy to change clothing, so, but that was more about they just weren't having a good time on that. That whole crew did not get along. I mean, everybody talked shit about everybody on that. The naked guy was talking shit. And not a happy, you know, there's some sets where people are, like, amazingly nice. Like, Castle, such a sweet, fun set to be on. Without a trace, that was, like, ice cold, so.
Well,
so
you set that up. I'm just going to tell them about, so if you're signing, you're going straight up, you're signing. And then you're also on the voice actor roundup panel at 1:30 in 301E. So you can catch in there for that panel as well.
So, we got one last question, then we'll play the video.
Could you please finish out with saying global saturation? What?
you there last night. Guys, did he miss a great panel last night?
Yes.
Yeah, it's like, I can't believe you people. Like, you come in the signature line, I said, you've got to come to the show. If you're a fan, you're going to be glad. You're going to be sad if you didn't. And then they show up the next day, going, will you do the line? Complete. Global. Saturation.
Thank you.